Oh, Chrissy, come away now. There's a farty light and your auntie wants her tea.
Coming, Uncle.
Yeah, you're in fine tune this morning, eh?
Oh, I am that, Uncle. No point in going around looking like a cow with a colic. Here, he those sticks to me.
Hi, Chrissy. You're getting happy by the sound of it.
Happy enough, Auntie.
Chris, I was talking to the postman yesterday.
Aye.
And he'd been talking to Mr. Gordon of Upper Hill. And who knows who else Mr. Gordon had been talking to? It's likely all over Kinradi by this time.
What is?
You were seen in Stonehaven yesterday with that Ewan Tavendale.
That's right. We took a walk out to Dunnottar together.
He's a coarse tink brute, Chris, from all that I hear.
It's a funny way to look at folk. To tie them up in wee packets and label them coarse or tinks or fine.
What are you havering about?
I'm just saying that they come spilling out of their packets at the very first shake, all mixed up and jumbled. I've never known a soul bite safe and sure in his pocket yet.
I'm talking to you about you and Tavendale. You should be ashamed of yourself, Chris.
I've got nothing to be ashamed of.
Oh, maybe no, but Kinradi will think different. You were seen hiding away down some hole by the sea. Now, folk will want to know what you did that for if you had nothing to hide.
I don't care. I don't care if the whole of Kinradi and the Mearns go mad and choke themselves in their bootlaces. What happened was between me and Ewan, and it's nobody else's business.
Mighty me, Chris, I was looking down the field there. There's no sign of a horse.
You could hardly have looked in the stable.
Oh, and how'd they come to be there?
I went out and fetched them in.
On a night like yon.
Oh, I had some help.
Who from?
Ewan Tavendale.
And he came back here, were you?
Aye, it was near dawn before he left.
Oh, Chrissy, what have you done? Oh, they're ashamed for you. I am sorry for you too. Oh, Tom will have to take her back with us.
There's no need to carry me off to Aberdeen to cover my shame. And there's nothing to cry about. Yet.
Yet?
Auntie Janet, you and I haven't lain together.
Well?
We'll wait till we're married.
He's to marry you then?
I hope so. But you never know.
Oh,
Auntie, I'm sorry. It's no fair tormenting you. It's just the mood I'm in.
Oh, well, it's plain you've no use for your relatives here. I only pray you don't come to disaster.
That's awful fine of you, Auntie.
Oh, she's turned a right course queen.
Yeah, it's not right, Janet, it's not right. Everything's gone to her and not a word about the two poor fatherless boys. I thought that Dawn and Alec would get their share. Else I might not have been so eager to adopt them.
No, she'll not keep it long. She doesn't care a button, that one.
Right course, Quine.
Well, are we up and pack?
Soon they were gone. And fair a relief was the riddance the place to myself again. And then it came on me that it wasn't again. It was just the first time. Laweary was mine. There wasn't a soul in the place but myself. Nobody had a right to come near it, but if I allowed.
Come in. Have you got your books unpacked all right?
Aye, and the room's fair comfortable, ma'am.
My name's Chris, Mistress Mellon. Oh. Now, how are we going to divide up the work between us?
Oh, whichever way you say, ma'am. Eh, Chris.
Well, I'd sooner see to the outside work myself. So I'll deal with the meats and the milking, and that'll leave you free to take care of the cooking and the cleaning.
That suits me just fine.
Then we'll get on right bravely. Oh, I'm expecting a visitor tonight. Will you show him into the parlour if I'm not here?
Oh, aye, I'll do that.
The honeysuckle was blinding sweet in the sun. And as I buried my face in it, I remembered the night before. And Ewan would be up to see me. Soon.
It's Mr. Tavendale, Chris.
Hello, Ewan.
Hello, Chris.
Give me your cap and away and sit by the fire. Thank you, Mistress Mellon.
Oh, Chris, lass. I never thought I'd get through the day.
Shh. Whisper. Mistress Mellon.
Is she outside listening?
Likely.
That man hath perfect blessedness.
I don't see how it's to be done, Chris. Not for a while, anyway. I've got no more than £100 saved up.
Is that the only reason, Ewan?
I swear to you. I'd marry you tomorrow if I could afford to, but we'll have to wait.
Ewan, I've been thinking about it all day. It's no credit to me, but I've got £300. Father was guy generous to me in his will.
No, I'm not using your money. It's not right.
Oh, listen to me,
Ewan. No, I don't like the notion, Chris. And even if I did, where would we get a place?
We've got a place. Blaweary. I kept on the lease and you could take it over. I still got all the gear in stock.
No. I won't have folks saying that my wife brought everything to the marriage.
Now, who'd say that?
Well, half a Conradi for a start. Maybe you yourself one day.
Oh, you're a proud, stubborn man.
It's getting late, Chris. I'd better be going.
Just think how fine it would be if there was no need for you to go back through the parks to Upper Hill.
You can find how to tempt me, Chris.
Get no kisses from me till you put your Highland pride in your pouch and say yes.
Aye. All right.
We arranged to be married on New Year's Eve, and we wrote our invitations to nearly every soul in Kinradi. So we planned a wedding we'd mind on when we both grew old. I knew that some would be sore affronted that I should marry so close to my father's death.
Your Aunt Janet and me would think black burning shame to attend such a marriage, especially with all the stir you intend. Alec and Dodd won't be coming either.
Mistress Mellon near burst her mickle face with amazement as the packages came pouring in. And she spread the story of our extravagance out through the howe.
Aye, Kirsty. And they tell me she's bought enough food to feed the French. She'll soon see the end of old Guthrie's cellar if she keeps that up.
With cooking and charving and tending to the beasts and getting the barn ready for the dance, I near went off my head. Ewan had his troubles too.
Aye, it's a fine thing to be joined in holy matrimony, Ewan. But I hardly think it seemly, Chris, to go about it with such a display of ostentation. Your father so recently deceased.
You didn't have to speak to him like that. He is the minister.
I just told him what I wanted was a wedding, not a sermon.
You shouldn't have said anything.
Oh, damn it, you're only married once as a general rule. It won't harm the old man in Kinradi Kirkyard.
You should learn to control your temper.
Now, don't be a fool.
There's no need for you to marry a fool, then.
Don't be feared. I've no such intention.
Damn it, Chris. I'm a coarse tink, right enough. I didn't mean to hurt you.
You didn't. It was myself. Oh, it'll no be plain sailing, Ewan. We've awful tempers, both of us.
There we are, Chris. Ah, the place looks as fine as a fairy palace in a picture book.
Oh, I'm right grateful to you. To you both, I don't know how I'd have managed. But it's getting late. Kirsty'll be wondering where you are.
Oh, she'll not mind. Ah, it's been a long time since we've had a wedding like this in Kinradi, you know.
Aye, that's true. Who's your musician?
I forgot the music.
Well, never mind. I'll bring the melodeon and Long Rob will bring his fiddle.
Faith, aye. And if that doesn't content the folks, then it's a kirk parade of the garden they're wanting and no wedding.
Well, well, Chris, I'll be home. Aye, this time tomorrow you'll be a married woman, Chris. Oh, well, sleep well tonight.
Aye, fine that.
Aye, I'll have to think about getting married myself. Well, it must be fine to sleep with a slim bit the like of yourself these cold, rife winter nights.
Ah, we meant faint the sleep you give her.
Night, lass.
Night, lass.
Good night, both. Thanks for your help.
Then they left me. And left me with such a lonesome feeling as I'd seldom had. Strange and eerie were the frozen flow of thoughts that came to me then. Daft thoughts had no need to think on my marriage eve. That this marriage of ours was nothing. That it would pass on and forward into days that had long forgotten it. And the face of the land would change and change again in the coming of the seasons and centuries. Then the sea would come flooding up the how, and all my love and tears for Ewan, not even a ripple on that flood of water far in the times to be.
For God's sake, away to your bed, lass. I'll tend the rest.
Aye, I'm just going.
I should think so. If you don't lie down, you'll look more like a bull for the butchers than a bride in the morning.
Aye, I suppose so. Good night, Mistress Mellon.
Good night.
Strange to think that tomorrow, and all the tomorrows, Ewan would share my room and my bed with me. Somehow it seemed that never again would I be myself and have this body that was mine and my own. So I lay counting how many hours it would be till morning. And oh, it was still so long.
Here to you, Chris.
Thanks, Posty. Now, isn't that nice of her? It's from Mistress Gibbon up at the manse.
And there are a canteen of cutlery arrived for the Gordons of Upper Hill. Enough knives and forks to keep you cleaning for a week and then no be finished.
Hello, Alan. Cheerio.
I'll be seeing you later, then.
It's as blast to drink your health as blackened your character, that one. Ah, well, now, Chris, how do you feel on your marriage morn?
Oh, I feel fine.
That's good. You know, I have known some creatures acquainted with fear hysterical, and others that shook with fright. Aye, and others that spoke so undecent you knew fine a man's bed was no anchor place for them.
I'm not afraid, Mistress Mellon.
No, and there's no need to be. You lads blithe and kind. Oh, my, I hope you'll be awful happy. And have two or three bairns before long.
Oh, well, you never know. Look at the time. I must see to the beasts.
Even they seem to guess there's something on the go. Chris, come away and get into your dress before the folk come up. It's best to have a wee touch of black ribbon with your father so recently gone. It's your mother you're thinking of, eh, lass? Oh, it's a most desolate thing to be without your mother on your wedding day.
I can't help it, Mistress Mellon. It just came to me that she's lying there, dead and forgotten in Kinraddy Kirkyard, with the twins beside her.
Oh, there, McQueen. She'd like it fine to have seen you in your bra things. But she wouldn't have wanted you crying for her.
I'm a fool. Where's my hanky? I don't want to look a fright before you and all the folk.
Them. I'll let them in.
I see you brought the livestock with you to the wedding, Jay.
No, no, that's a present to Chris and Ewan. Oh. From the old folks at Netherhill.
Oh, it's
two fucking hens, good layers, both of them.
It's a pity the old buddies couldn't come themselves, Jay.
Aye, but they're a bit too old now. Look, lassie, let me do this for you.
Thanks, Jay.
It's best to have a man at that end of the stand, dear.
Dan, those two hens have got out.
Oh, good, so they have.
That's a job, then.
I'm trying, man.
Get out of the dark. Come here.
God, I used to be care where it was going as long as it was anywhere out of flow.
Now, wait a minute, you make a fair fuss about nothing.
Oh, no doubt such like work would be nothing to you, seeing as how you've chased ostriches out in the Transvaal. But I have no training for it myself.
It's not enough. You, Rob. I'm glad you're hard work.
Thanks, Chris. Well, here's to the bonniest maid Conradi will mind for many a year.
The great fool might wait for tea before he starts his speechifying.
You fair offended, Mistress Monroe. That's likely because nobody ever said she was bonny.
If anybody ever has, he's an uncommon liar.
Come away and get a dram, Mr. Gibbon.
No, thank you very much.
You've been communing with Mother Earth. I see, Mr. Gibbon.
Well, here. If anybody wants to wet their whistle, there's only a few minutes before the wedding begins. Oh, here's the groom now.
How are you in?
I think you should go up and tidy your knees.
And when I came down, there were all the folks sitting in chairs, as solemn as a kirk congregation. I couldn't see clear for a minute then. Or maybe too clear. I didn't seem to be seeing with my own eyes at all. Then Ewan and I stood side by side. His face was solemn and white.
I help us in the name of the Lord.
And I knew him more frightened than I was myself.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered here together.
And something of my own fear went from me then.
This congregation to join together this man and this woman.
I listened to the words the minister was reading.
Which is unholy estate instituted by
words that I'd never heard before.
Which was beautified and
this was the first marriage I'd ever been at.
May God bless this union and give them the courage and strength for the difficulties that the years may bring. And make fruitful their marriage and their love as pure and enduring in its fulfillment as in its conception. Mistress Tavendale. Well done. In fact, I can say that the whole thing has been well done. And not like some of the weddings I've made. And Guy Funny, some of them were, I can tell you.
Eat something, Chris. You'll be fair famished.
I'm too excited to eat.
Here, try some of Mrs. Mellon's dumpling. Everybody's praising it.
Oh, aye, they would. It's few that's eaten anything for dinner in Conradi today. There wouldn't be much sense with a marriage in prospect. Ewan, I'm so pleased that everything's been just and right.
And then again came that qualm of doubt separating me from these kindly folk of the farms. Kind, and I ready to believe the worst they heard of others. Unbelieving that others could think the same of themselves. Then next instant, I forgot them in a glow of remembrance that blinded all else. I was married to Ewan.
Right, Rob. The best man's had his say. It's your turn to speak.
No, 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 speeches.
You're glib enough at any other time.
Well, I've never been married myself. I've been too much respect for those kettle folk women. But Marriage, I think, is like the yoking together of two two-year-olds. They're skittish and brisk in the first bit rig, but it's the second rig, it's a testing time. It's then, you know, when one's pulling and the other's holding back. Well, but I won't say any more about horses. It's a fascinating topic. I'll just come back to the marriage and say that we all wish the best to Chris, so sweet and trig, and to Ewan, the Highland catering. And long may they live, grow healthy, wealthy, and well content. Chris and Ewan.
Right, folks. The night's wearing on. Who's game for a dance at Chris's wedding? Eh?
Ewan was dancing with some quine from the mains, and some were watching me to see how I took it. I heard the whisper that I'd have all my work cut out looking after him. Coarse among the quines he was, Ewan Tarvindale. But I didn't care. I knew it was a lie. Ewan was mine and mine only. But I wished he would dance with me for a change.
Right. You're the bonniest thing ever seen in Kinradi.
Where's the bride and groom, folks? Damned, they're lost. Away, you greedy brute, you in. Waitress is yours forever and diamond. Let me tell you something, Chris. Never doubt your Ewan. Well, never let him know that you doubt him. That's the hell of married life. Raise him up and tell him he's fine. If there's not another soul in the house can stand up beside him. And if you do that, he'll want to cuddle you till the day he dies. Aye, he'll blush at the sight of you 50 years on as much as he does a day.
I'll try. Thanks, Jay.
Ach, it must be the whiskey speaking. I better play a little melodeon. Oh, God.
Easy in married life, but not over easy. That's been my ruin, though God knows it'll make not a difference in 100 years' time.
I don't know what you mean.
I mean, don't let Ewan saddle you with a burden full of bairns, Chris. It kills you and eats the heart out of you. For by the unease and the dirt of it. They're all the same men. You'll maybe not well steer clear of the first, Chris. Nor yet of the second. But you belong to yourself. Mind you that, lass.
Is the man of the house not here, eh? Well, Chris, you'll just have to make do with me.
No, it was that muckle slummock saying to you.
Oh, nothing, Rob, just advice.
Damn, that's the curse of the human race, Chris, listening to advice. Don't let any of these damned women fear you.
But I'm listening to yours now, aren't I?
Oh, your head's screwed on and you'll manage fine. But mine, if there's ever a thing you want with a friend, not to speak it abroad all over Kinraddy, I'll be there at the mill to help you.
That's kind of you, Rob. But I'll have Ewan. What else could I want?
Aye, you'll have Ewan. Here he is. Man, you neglected your wife. Where have you been?
I've just been out at the stables. Do you know who's there?
No.
Monroe. He's lying in the stall beside Clyke with his arms round the beast.
Man, oh, bit the horse looked right disgusted.
I did that. I tried to move him, but damn him, he wouldn't.
Put him in a song.
Fuck, I'll manage that fine. But first we'll have one from the bride herself. How about it, Chris?
Oh, no.
Go on, come on. Here
it was a song that I brought me near to weeping, and did now, and not me alone with Rob's fiddle whispering it out, the sadness and the soreness of it, though it was long, long syne. It came on me then, how strange was the sadness of Scotland singing, made for the sadness of the land and sky in dark autumn evenings. The crying of men and women of the land, of things wept for, remembered at night and twilight. The gladness and kindness had passed, lived and forgotten. It was Scotland of the mist and rain and the crying sea that made the songs.
Damned folks. We'll all have the whimsies. We'll listen to any more warsome songs. Well, if any of you got a cheerful one. Well, it's near a quarter to 12, another dance, and we've all to go to the heave of the chap at midnight.
Come on, miss.
Come on.
It wasn't like wakening from a dream, Marion, but more like going into one. And I wasn't sure, not for days, what things we'd dreamt and what actually done. Me, and this farmer of Blueary, who would stir of a morning at the jangle of the clock and creep from bed. I was never far behind him that bitter winter. And I loved even the frozen mornings. He'd be gone to the bar and stable as I came down and sought out the porridge meal and put it to boil. Then I'd open the kitchen window and gasp in the bite of the wind, seeing a grey world on the edge of morning.
You on!
No way, woman, you're still asleep. Up in the mornings, I think.
Sit down and take your porridge.
Have you fed the hens?
Not yet.
I'll do it.
Oh, don't, Haver, I can do that myself.
Oh, damn it, I've got to do something.
There's little to be done in Blueweary with the weather the way it is.
Aye, I wish it would clear. Even the horses are feeling the want of exercise. Clyde and Bess are going daft in their stalls.
Have you mucked out the byre?
Aye, and the Kye have had their turnips.
Then why don't you take the gun up to the moors? The grocer was saying he'd buy what spare rabbits we have.
Aye, I might do that. Or I was thinking, I might take a load of corn up to the mill for bruising. We're running low.
And all that afternoon he was away. I fretted from room to room. But it crept into my mind that his going to the mill had ended the foolishness that shut us in fast from Kinraddy and all the world. Us two alone. With all the gladness that was ours alone. And my kisses the most that Ewan would ever seek. And kisses ending days and nights, and almost life itself for me. The winter wore on to its close, and mid-February brought the sun, weather that might well have come out of a May.
Done well this morning and it's barely gone nine. Folk will be saying young Blueweary is just showing off, starting his ploughing 2 days before the rest of Kinraddy.
Well, let them. Jay Strachan's got his pair of horse out today. So is Upper Hill and Cuddiston. Yeah, the cattle.
Oh, they're all right now. They were just daft and delighted with the first spring dander. It's aye the same when they're turned out for the first time.
Aye, maybe. But I'm too busy to go chasing down the road after them.
It was comic watching you running after them across the parks, swearing blue murder.
And if the postman hadn't met them, they might well be running still. They're not the only things that go daft the first blink of sunshine. Your hands are sore and red with all the scrubbing you've been doing.
Oh, it has to be done. The house is all wrong. It's foul and feckless.
Every time I come in for my dinner, I find the kitchen heaped high with gear from some room you're scrubbing. You're daft, Chris. The house is fine. What more do you want?
I want less dirt. Maybe you like dirt, but I don't.
Well, maybe I do. I like you right well.
Oh.
Hold off, you shameless limmer. You're not 19 yet.
But it was
you. Away you go. Let me finish. This weather won't hold much longer. There's rain behind it.
Look at it. It's been pelting down for a bloody fortnight. You can't see your hand in front of your face outside.
I'm on Blueberry. Never seen the like. Except once when I was in Alaska. Aye, the mountains move there from the snows are melting.
Well, Alaska can move under the sea in the morning for all I care. When will it clear in Blueberry?
But clear it did. And you could feel the coming of spring. And hear it singing and rilling over the fields. Life itself seemed to flow up through the spring. Ewan had the land all ploughed and sown, and I helped him carry the corn. And I liked that fine. So the weeks slipped by, until that day when I knew I would never be my own again. In my body, the seed of that pleasure I had sown with Ewan burgeoned and grew, dark in the warmth below my heart. But I didn't tell you. Not that night, nor the week that followed, nor the weeks after that. Watching my body with a secret care and fluttering eyes for the marks and stigmata of this thing that had come to me. And once, something moved there under my heart. moved and stirred drowsily, a sleeper from dreams. And I gasped and cried, and then lay still, not wakening Ewan. For this was my rig and furrow. I had brought him the unsown field, and the tending and reaping was mine.
All right, where's the breakfast then?
In a minute.
Damn it, Chrissy, you're still asleep. What's wrong? I've got the turnips to hoe. The first of them's up today.
Have you no thought for anything but your parks and your beasts?
Chris, what's up?
Morning, noon and night, they're all you care for. You love them better than you do me. I'm just here to warm your bed at night and set your meat down by day.
What are you glowering for?
For God's sake, don't leave me. Must I be like an old wife and trailing after me wherever I go?
You got out of bed the wrong side this morning. And I'd like my breakfast before the night comes down.
You speak to me like that? Do you think I'm your servant? You're mine. Mind that. Living off my meat and milk. Highland pauper.
You dumb bitch.
You'd say that to me. To me.
Ah, you're ill. You should be in your bed.
God, Chris, he gone daft. What are you screaming for? What do you want?
That.
Oh, get up. Damn you. Get up.
No. No.
Chris. Chris. Come back.
Never go back. I'll drown myself in the loch. Then I stopped. My heart seemed near to bursting. And terribly, below it, something seemed to move and uncoil. Had anything happened with it? Oh, God, there couldn't be anything. The days of love and the foolishness of kisses, they might be for you and yet, but never the same for me. Dreams were fulfilled, and their days put by. The hills climbed to the sunset, but my heart might climb with them never again and long for tomorrow. The night still my own. No night would I ever be my own again. Stay by me. Stay by me.
Mind you quiet, lass.
And Chris Guthrie crept out from where Chris Tavendale lay and went wandering off into the waiting quiet of the afternoon. Chris Tavendale heard her go, and she came back to Blaweary, never again.
What's this you've been doing, Chris Guthrie?
Don't know. Where's Ewan?
I'm here, Chris.
Ah, he ran all the way to Peasy's Nap. Well, that's fine. Now let's be seeing a bit more of you, young Mistress Tavendale. Ah, it's fine. Uh-huh. And you tell me you didn't know what this thing was, Chris Tavendale.
Oh, yes.
But not Ewan.
Oh. What is it? What's the matter?
You're going to be a father, Blaweary man. What do you think of that?
You mean Chris is...
I'll wait and make me a cup of tea while Chris and I go into more intimate details.
God, Chris, why didn't you tell me?
You needn't abide, Ewan. She's safe enough for me. Bonnie though she is. Now, away with you now and make the tea.
I'll do that.
Aye. Right, Chris, let's see if everything's all right.
Her a market for to see, I fell in with a wealthy farmer. A man yours a little catty.
It's damned easy for him to sing, eh, Chris? Still, you'll be singing yourself when this bairn of yours comes into the world.
Why, is there something wrong?
No, there's nothing wrong. You've a body as fine and natural and comely as a cow or a rose, Chris Guthrie. You've no need to worry, so don't fret. No, but look after yourself. Eat plenty of vegetables. And still be as kind to Ewan as the wear of the months will let you be. Good for you and good for him.
All right. Where's that tea, then?
With Ewan knowing, it was as though a bank had gone down. But no torrent or storm came to blind and overwhelm me. There was nothing but the corn growing and the peewits calling. Summer coming, marching up each morning with unbraided hair.
Chris! Don't run!
And you don't blether. There's no need to fret. I'm not a doll.
You have to be careful.
The doctor said I'd be safe as a cow. I hope to God I don't look like one.
You look fine. Bonnier than ever.
I can hardly believe that this weather will last.
It won't. Not in the nature of things. The rain comes in the night. Just enough, not more. You could want for better sun in the day.
Maybe things are changing for the better all round.
Damn your fears. I'm certain some trick's on up there.
Oh, well, we'll enjoy it while it lasts. I've been scrubbing out my old room. I'd like the bairn to be born in it.
Aye, there's to be a family down in Beweria here. Chris must fear a taking at the first bit set.
Maybe. If you ask me, the taking was well before the marriage.
Is that a fact? It's the Speaker Kinradi. They say that Ewan only married the quine when she threatened him with the law.
I'll go out and kick the backsides off.
Oh, don't be daft, Ewan. Folk would think it all the truer, the scandal. If it makes them any happier to think as they do, let them think.
Dirty-minded tinks.
Oh, Ewan, I could almost wish that we had bedded unblessed. The bairn would have been here by now. Sit in and take your meat and don't worry about it anymore.
Ewan,
Edmund. Aye, come in, Jay.
Have you seen the paper? There's a war on. Britain's at war with Germany.
Oh, aye.
Is that all you have to say? I'm telling you, there's a war on, man.
Aye, haven't you? But I've got other things to think about. I mean, how's your corn coming on, Jay? I mean, I doubt if this weather doesn't break it, it'll ruin it.
Oh, here, man, read it for yourself.
Ah, you and your war. Well, they can fight till they're black and blue, as far as I'm concerned. If only the lay field would come on a bit faster. And the straw is that short, it would fair break your heart.
And out he went in the evening light, down to the lay park, and poked about there, rig to rig, as though he was coaxing the corn to grow and ripen in the night, for his delight in the morning. A bairn with a toy, I thought. And then came that movement in my body, as that other seed of his burgeoned and ripened, and grew to harvest.
Ewan! Ewan!
Did you shout? What is it, Chris? The bairn?
Aye, it'll maybe be a long time yet, but get Jay to drive with the doctor and the nurse from Burvey.
I can't leave you like this.
Hurry, I'm fine.
Go and lie down.
I can't find what to do. Now hurry, will you?
Aye.
Myself swearing and swearing. Terrible words I hadn't known I knew, but it was better than screaming. And then Ewan was back and emerged from the white blur. But something was worrying me.
What did you eat after your dinner?
Hey?
Boil yourself an egg, you.
What? Do you want something, Chris? Boil what, did you say?
Oh, boil your head if you like. Ewan, help me up to my room.
Well, Chris, lass, how do you feel? It's a fine thing to send for us in such a stewer, and here we come tearing up to find you sleeping like a lamb. This is Mistress Ogilvy. You've heard of her.
Dreams. Terrible dreams. My father and Will and burning like a furnace.
Don't you bother with that now. Do you feel you're getting on fine?
It shouldn't be very long now. I'll wait downstairs.
Oh! Now, don't you do that, Mistress Tavendale. Don't grip yourself up. Slacken and it's easy. Wish it to come. There's a brave girl. Wish it to come. That's it.
Shouldn't you be up there with her, Doctor?
Man, if there's one thing I hate, it's a confinement. You got your corn in yet, Mr. Strachan?
No, why? Either you and Mr. Thurston can ride here.
You've been lucky with the weather, by all accounts.
Oh, I have that. Mm. Oh, it's been gay wet up by the D folks, eh? And down at Forfar, there's been a wet year.
You're doing fine, lass. Fine.
Have you picked a name for him yet? If it's a boy, that is.
Oh, Chris wants to call him Ewan. God, what's keeping them? What's the time?
Oh, it's just 12 o'clock and no more. And you're Ewan Tavendale has just come into the world, man.
My baby. Beside you. Don't crush him. My baby. He's bonny and perfect.
Wheesh, now he's sleeping. My, you're the lucky one. Bringing in the best in the forenoon. Some folk have to thresh from dawn to dusk. Aye, and through another night to another day.
Aye. I know. And then the baby opened its eyes and fluttered them at me and yawned. And I saw a tongue like a little red fish in the little red mouth. And the blue shaded eyelids went down again. And young Ewan Tavendale slept. He was hungry.
The nurse said I could come up. I was up before, but you were asleep. Oh, Chris.
Mind your baby.
God, am I like to forget?
Here's the grand pair of Ewan landed. Get on and let's get a start this plane. What you see?
£1.4 So is Chris.
Hey, man, the mart's bad today. Seems nobody wants to speak of anything but the war.
Good fair day of you. Mitch and Monroe were going around saying they'd miss the morning if they were younger.
Aye, I saw them. They looked as though they'd a fair drink in their bellies.
Aye, they had. And it was the drink talking. I hear James Leslie. You know, they took your place as foreman at Upper Hill.
Aye.
So we up to Aberdeen tomorrow to join the guard.
Ah, he's daft. Showing off, looking for a holiday. The war will soon be over.
You think so?
The newspapers say it will.
Oh, aye, the papers are right fierce. And some of those editors are rough creatures. God pity the Germans if they laid their hands on them.
Aye, the newspaper billies are hard to counter.
Mind, the Germans just go on with their raping the women and gutting the bairns. They don't seem to care. But maybe the Germans don't read the papers.
My God, it makes you sick just to read it. I'm off to Warriton, Les.
You're havering, man. You don't mean it.
Damn it, I do.
What about Kirsty?
What about Peasy's now?
Oh, guess they'll be all right, and her father can look after the farm. I'm telling you, Ewan, we'll all need to fight for our wives and bairns before this war's over. Night, Chris.
Night, G.
Oh, that'll cause a speak and a stir in Kinraddy. Oh, Che's just being patriot daft. He doesn't know when he's being laughed at.
Poor Kirsty. Oh, Ewan, this war's causing a fair upset. Sugar's awful up in price. I was thinking I should maybe get some from the grocer and store it away in the barn.
Aye, you might as well. I was thinking of going to the kirk on Sunday.
I thought you couldn't bear with the kirk.
Oh, well, I might break my habit this time. I was hearing the Reverend Gibbon preached a gay queer sermon last Sabbath. He might do the same again.
The crowd that turned up to hear his sermon was more than the previous week, and the place was all on edge to hear what he would say. There was nothing unusual as he gave out the hymn and the prayer. But then he took the text. It was about Babylon's corruptions. They'd been a right course lot there.
And I say this, Babylon was no more corrupt than the wicked and lustful world we live in today. God has sent the Germans for a curse on the world because of its sins. God's anger is loosed as it was in the days of Attila. How long it will rage, to what depths of pain your punishments will go, only God in his anger will know. But from this chastisement by blood and fire, the nations may rise anew, as Scotland, not least in its ancient health and humility, to tread again the path.
I'll no stay here and listen to that brute defending these cursed German tanks and some friend of his called Attila. No more will I, Kirsten.
Dear friends, I...
Let us pray.
I finished early and rattled off the blessing as though it was a cursing.
Is it true that some of the young folk were waiting for him in the kirkyard?
They were going to clout him in the lug when he came out. But the elders were there and edged them away. Gibbon just made for the manse and padlocked the gate.
Did you hear that, Ewan?
Gibbon might be right or wrong about his Babylons and whores. And he can slobber on about Attila every night of the week. I don't care one way or the other.
That's so?
Yep, Blowery's got all its crops in. That's all that matters.
Well, I've made time for the pro-Germans. That's what the papers call them. British folk that think these German rascals are right. The papers are full of the pro-Germans now.
I was reading that in England folk went and smashed their windows in.
Serves them right, no wonder. Folk are in our age with the pro-Germans being so coarse.
Ach, what a blither about a war. Isn't it, Ewan?
Hey, Chris. Did you see him look at me just then?
Oh, aye. I dare say you're both douce and safe and blithe here at Blueary.
Have you heard from Jay?
Aye. I had a letter last Saturday. He's joined the North Highlanders. They're sending him to Perth.
Kinraddy's an unco place without him.
Oh, Chris, he'll never come back.
Oh, he will. It'll all be over long before he's sent to France.
It's such a rage with the Germans being so coarse. He'll just run forward into his bit of the front and kill till he's fair lost himself.
Maybe they're not such bad folk as the papers make out.
See you another... Damn pro-German as well, you... Kirsty, there's aren't many of your kind in Kinraddy. Kirsty,
I can go, Chris. You know what she's like. In a week's time, she'll be ashamed of her outburst. Aye, likely the Reverend Gibbon will have second thoughts about his.
And I tell you this, the Kaiser is the Antichrist. Until the Germans have been beaten and this foul evil swept from the earth, there will be neither peace nor progress.
The Reverend Gibbons fear become a patriot. But it's more likely he thinks the chance of losing his Gherkin collection a damn sight worse than any German that was ever clicked.
Oh, it's fair scandal all through the Howe. You can hardly believe it. Long Rob doesn't hold with the war.
It's a lot of damn nonsense. Those that want to fight, the MPs and bankers and editors, should be locked up in a park and made to gut each other with grapes.
The man's a pro-German, that's what he is, a pro-German.
There'll be no great loss to the world. A fine bit sight it would make for decent folk to look on.
Well, the others can do what they like. I'm not so daft as to leave the best miller for miles around, just because he says all the Germans can hardly be tinks.
It's a folk with sense to take part in the sauce and yammer of king and country is just plain hysteria. And as for Belgium being invaded, got what it needed. What about the Congo? Not that the Germans aren't as bad. War tarred with the same black brush.
Och, there's little danger that anybody'll smash Rob's windows. Rob's a well-liked Billy, and you needn't heed his blether. The whole store will soon blow over.
And I say this, that even as Jael showed her patriotism and holiness in killing Sisera, to become a light unto Israel, so must we in like manner act the same. Right here, in our midst, there are traitors that side with the Antichrist. Shame on Kinraddy that it be so.
Here's the Kaiser's crony. Come on, let's duck the mucker.
Aye, lads, and are you having a bit of exercise after your Sunday dinner?
You'll soon find out, Duncan. The minister made a few suggestions about how to deal with pro-Germans.
And what am I this time? Long Rob, the Antichrist's friend.
Come on, lads, into the barn we are.
Aye.
Come on, lads.
There's a whole crowd of Billies away up to the mill, and I think they mean Rob some harm.
Do they?
Smashing my window, would you then? Would you, you scum? Take care, man! Put down that gun!
Oh. Hey, that sounded like Rob's shotgun.
These folk will think the Germans have landed and are looting the Mearns.
Look! Man, Rob, what's this?
Just some billies that had a notion to duck me in the mill barn.
By God, they'll hardly sit down for a week with the pellets on their backsides. Patriots. It's a damn poor show for Scotland if a patriot's iron is hard as that.
You're no hurt, Rob.
No, I'm fine. But I know somebody that won't be.
Stand out my way there, Rob.
After you tell me what the hell you meant by saying that I was friends with the Antichrist.
Get out my way!
Stand you still first, my man, for we've a bit of a bone to pick.
Now, who's pro-German?
Europe!
You're a coarse tank brute, Duncan. I heard what happened at the mill. And if you weren't to fight like that, you should go to France and do it.
I'd made up my mind that I'd smash your bit nose for you.
You just strike and strike until the bone gives way.
I'm warning you, Duncan.
You're just a half-witted cleric. Get going while the going's good and your hide's intact.
So that was the result of the Reverend Gibbon's sermon. And for a few days, Kinraddy fair seethed with the news. But I didn't care. Sitting there at Blaweary with young Ewan at my breast, and my man beside me. We knew there was a war and bloodshed, and that was awful, but far off also. You'd hear it like the North Sea crying in the morning. A crying and a thunder that became unending as the weeks went by. It was part of life's plan, fringing the horizon of your days with its pelt and uproar. So it went on in the winter and into the next year.
Spring of life, eh, Chris Quine? Sing it and cherish, for it'll never come again.
Hello, Rob. You looking for Ewan?
Aye.
He's ploughing up on the Brayside.
Oh, aye. Oh, I've just a few bills to settle with one of my few customers.
Are Murch and Curriston still carting their corn up to the mill at Mundine?
Aye. They'll have nothing to do with a pro-German.
Does Monroe still call you that?
He does. Ah, oh, but not in my face. He's all coarse in the feet, Monroe, to run as fast as the other billies. Ewan's doing well. I hear he's taking in a drove of Irish steers. They'll fatten well. 1916's been a good year for grass.
Aye. I'm fair proud of the amount of beasts of Blaweary. You know, Rob, I can hardly believe that it was here that my father chaved and fought for a living the way he did.
Aye, Chris, but that was before the war.
Man, Jay, you look right fine as a soldier. The lasses will all be wanting your buttons. And what's this you've got in your arm, Lenny?
Och, they made a corporal of me just.
You'll be right proud of yourself, Jay, aye. And so you should be, doing your patriotic duty.
Alec, you're still a fell great patriot.
I was one of the first to enroll with the Glenbervy Volunteers. Man, Jay, we were making some fearsome sacrifices for this war. I was down at Drumlithy every other night for the drilling.
Oh, it was a sight for sore eyes. The gowks prancing about like dogs with diarrhea.
Eh?
That's what you reminded me of. And when do you think the war will end, she?
Oh, God only knows.
Oh, you still believe in him, then?
Well, maybe I have my doubts sometimes.
And how are all the folks at Kinraddy then?
Oh, fine, Jay, fine. There have been changes, but all for the better, as you see for yourself.
Ah, oh, that's more than some. Well,
what do you mean?
The Gordon boy. He was wounded out in France. He got blinded.
Oh, it's a fell pity.
He fair screamed at his mother when she went to see him. He pulled aside the bandages and showed her the great red holes in his head. Aye, he said he'd be home right soon. To crawl around the parks and show them to every bitch in the Mearns that's looking for a hero.
When do you think it'll finish, then?
Oh, devil knows, Ewan. My year's not so bad if it wasn't for the lice.
Lice?
Oh, God, they're awful. Oh, but don't be feared, Chris. Kirsty made me stand outside and strip off everything I had on. She flung all my clothes into one tub and made me get into another, so I'm felt clean now.
What do you think of the Germans? Oh, yes, of course, as folks say.
I'm damned if I know. You've hardly seen one alive. I've seen one or two bodies now and then. Aye, bodies, grey, green, and... There's a supper on the table.
But you must have met up with some live ones in the fighting.
Oh, I've been out there, you hardly fight at all. You just lie about those damn bit trenches and have a kick at the soil they're made of.
Clay, is it, like round here?
It's clay in a kind of black marble. It's funny land. Mind you, the French are no use as farmers at all. They just plighter and potter about these damn little parts. You'd hardly use them as a hanky to blow your nose.
You don't sound over fond of them.
I don't like them at all. They're damn poor folk to fight for. Meaner than dirt. Not half as sweet.
You don't think I should join up then, Jane?
Ewan.
There's fools enough in the fighting as it is.
I was asking only.
Kirsty!
Aye, Che, just you lie still. I'll be up in a minute.
Kirsty! What the hell? How long has this been going on?
What's going on? What are you talking about?
The larch wood. There's folk cutting down the larch wood.
Oh, aye. Makes a guy difference to the lookout. But the woodmen have been a grand thing for Kinraddy. They've been lodging here and paying fine and well for their board.
The hell with their board, the bastards. They're ruining my land, you hear? I got to sort them.
Have you gone fair mad with the killing of Germans?
Look, have you no eyes in your head, you fool? Why didn't you tell me this in your letters? If that wood's cut down, it'll lay the whole place open to the northeast. And that's fair the end of a living for anybody here.
I'm no fool, Chase Strachan. And if that's the case, we'll be no worse off than the other folk here. All the woods in Kinraddy are due to come down.
And when I went out and looked, she was right. Over by the mains, they came upon the woodmen, teams and teams of them. And above up our hill, they cut down the larch. Spared nothing but the ewes at the manse.
Aye, the trustees have sold the timber right well. It's wanted for aeroplanes and such like things.
I minded these woods often when I was out in France, Rob. So bonny they were. And thick and grave. Fine shelter and light for the cattle. I went to see the factor about it.
It'll be all right, Mr. Strachan. The government's going to replant all the trees as soon as the war's been won.
That'll console me a bloody lot, I'm sure. And then he said, we must all do our bit at sacrificing something. And what sacrifices is he? You may tell me that, you scrawny wee mucker, I said.
Ah, well, maybe that's no fair, Che. He's a decent enough child and no fit to fight.
Oh, I was that mad. I don't know what I said to him. I don't much care.
That's true, though. Folk have changed. Near every soul in Kinraddy's making money and they don't care that the war outlasts their lives. Much is making money like a dung heap makes surricks.
Hen.
Oh, why, we're doing fine. I got myself a new car and the wife's bought herself a piano. Man, you'll be wanting to get back to the front line, eh?
Back to the front line. You'd fare wrong in the betting. I asked him if he ever heard of a woman wanting a new bairn put back in her womb. The gowk-eyed gomeral. And it was just the same everywhere I went. There's not one of them cares if the whole place is laid waste and shaved of its timbers till it's just a waste of heath and heather. They're money mad, Rob. I went over to Cuddiston. Oh, but they were so busy that hardly time to notice me.
Oh, we're rearing chickens with 100 che in these bit incubators. The hospitals in Aberdeen pay a fine price for them. Well, we'd better get on with our work. Fine being a soldier like you with your holidays and all, but poor folk I have to work.
Aye. She's aye been a thin-nibbed, footed creature, that one.
Oh, Monroe was real shame for her. But he'd hardly time to offer me a dram, so anxious he was with his new brood of hens. Now that it mattered, the place got on my stomach.
You'll have heard the Reverend Gibbons gone.
Aye, he's a colonel chaplain in Edinburgh, someone like that.
Oh, I'm told he wears a right brave uniform with a black hunky round the neck of it. His father's come to take his place.
What's he like?
Oh, an old bit stock that drinks German blood by the gill with his porridge by the way he preaches.
And yet I still think this war'll bring some good to the world, Rob. Yeah. It'll be the end of armies and fighting forever.
Evers?
No. The day of socialism will dawn. The common folk have seen what their guns can do and they'll use them if they have to when they come back.
The common folk when they aren't sheep or swine. You're an exception, man. Being a goat.
Well, we'll see. I'd best get back to Kirsty. My leave's not long to go.
Oh, it'd come with the morning, man, if only.
If only what, man?
If only I wanted to be easy. Easy and a liar. But I've never gone that gate yet, and I'm damned if I'll begin it for any bit war.
That year, the harvest came in fine. And I thought it near time that another bairn should come to Blue Eyrie. And, as the nights went on, I whispered to myself, in the spring, I'll tell him.
Aye, Chris, conscription. You'll have heard about it, surely.
It means that folk have to fight whatever they say, and they get shot if they don't.
That's about it. Ah, but don't worry about Ewan. They don't take folks that farm their own land. Though likely you'll have to go up to Aberdeen with the rest of us to be examined.
But what about yourself, Rob?
My papers came this morning.
Oh, Rob.
Fine. Ah, I like a bit of a jaunt.
Tell me what happened.
Well, there was a whole crowd of us in the one carriage, mostly ploughmen. All of them swearing they didn't give a button whether they were taken or not.
What about Rob?
He just sat there, smoked his pipe, and said nothing. It was the same at the place we went to. They finished with the ploughmen, and the whole jing-bang went past the soldiers. Except me, of course. And then they called Long Rob. He wouldn't stir out of his jacket, even.
What's so funny?
Oh, Chris, you should have seen them. They danced round him, swore at him, and he just puffed his smoke up into their faces. Calm as you like. As if there were a cloud of midges on a summer's day.
Now, be reasonable, man. You were supposed to have reported to Aberdeen Barracks a couple of days back.
Aye.
You can find that your case has been heard by the Exemption Board in Stonehaven.
Aye. They tell me the chairman's a wee grocer man that works night and day to send other folk to fight the Germans.
They said you couldn't have exemption.
Aye, that was sad.
Damn it. How do you like the idea of other folk calling you a coward?
Fine, man, fine. I'd rather any day be a coward than a corpse.
Oh, I've no more time to argue. Are you coming or are you not?
If you want me, carry me.
Couldn't hardly do that.
Faith, no. You'd look fair daft wheeling me along the road in the tail of your bicycle.
And when they came for him, it needed three of them to take Rob of the Mill off to the war. And what happened to him next? There arose this rumour. Some said he was in jail. Some said he'd given in. Some said he'd escaped and was hiding in the hills. But nobody knew for sure. Che was gone. Rob was gone. Our best friends were out of Kinradi now. But we had ourselves.
You want me to see to the cattle before I muck out the stable?
Damn it, man, you should have both done by this time. You've been standing about with your hands in your pockets.
No, but I...
Well, see to the stables, man.
You shouldn't talk to Brigson like that, Ewan. He seems to be getting the set of things at Lewiri now.
He's handless. I'd never have taken him on if the crops hadn't come on so thick.
Anyway, we're lucky to have him with things the way they are. And he's making real friends with young Ewan.
Oh, he is, is he?
What's wrong, Ewan?
Nothing.
You've been like this for days, just sitting at your meat, silent and saying nothing. Are you feeling ill, or is there something troubling
you? Damn it, I said there was nothing. Keep an eye on Brigson while I'm away.
Where are you going?
To Aberdeen, if you must know.
Bed, John. I'll finish these.
No, no, I'll lend a hand with the dishes. Goodbye, I've still got the cattle to tend.
John, I'm sorry the master spoke to you the way he did. He was just out of temper this morning. He's worried about his business. That's why he's away to Aberdeen.
Oh, never heed, mistress. He'll be as right as rain when he gets back tonight.
Aye. I was expecting him off that last train.
Oh, but there's another train still at 10 o'clock.
Oh, it's you, mistress. I thought I heard somebody moving about. But why are you not in your bed?
John, he's not back. I walked a wee bit down the road to meet him, but the last train's been gone half an hour. Do you think something's happened to him?
No. What could have happened to the master?
I don't know. Maybe he got knocked down or something.
Oh, no, they'd have sent you a telegram. No, he just missed the train in here. He'll have got one as far as Stonehaven. He'll be walking from there.
Aye, that's what's happened. I'll wait to your bed, John.
Good night, then, mistress.
Good night, John.
Good night.
So quiet. In the night air, you could smell the turned grass of the ploughlands, wet with the fresh fallen dew. So young the year, and so sweet. I'd make it this night, a night with you, and I'd planned. But the night had gone, and still Ewan hadn't come back. Nor came he back that day, nor many a day beyond that. But the postman at noon brought me a letter. It was from Ewan.
Dear Chris, I've grown sick of having folk like Mutch and Monroe always laughing and sneering at me for being a coward. So I've joined the North Highlanders. I'll be writing to let you know where they have sent me. In the meantime, you're not to worry. Yours truly, Ewan.
Hi, mistress. Is the master not back yet?
He won't be back.
Oh, what's happened?
He's joined up.
Has he? Oh, I'm kind of sorry to hear that. Stella will likely be over before he's finished his training.
Do you think so, John? Do you really think so?
Of course it will. I see the Germans are retreating in all the fronts. They're fierce, scared white to see when your lads start to the bayonet.
What?
I said the Germans were terrified of the bayonet, and no wonder. Cold steel, that's the stuff right in the belly.
John.
Eh? Oh, I'm sorry, mistress.
If you've ever gutted a rabbit or a hen, you can guess what's inside a man.
I'm sorry, mistress, but he'll be all right. You've not to worry.
that year, the rain came down from the northeast. The woodmen had gone, and the country, once sheltered and life, was open to whatever storm might come. Oh, but that spring was long with Ewan away.
Oh, Chris, I believe you hardly know me.
Well.
Oh, Chris. Come on, stop it, lass. You'll have me crying myself.
Oh, Will, I just can't believe it. Is it really you?
Oh, it's me, all right.
Oh, Chris. Here, give me that coat. You must be drenched. Oh, Will.
Here. Faith, the place has hardly changed at all. Oh, Chris, you mind you used to sit at this table with your books and studies?
There'll be plenty of mind this and mind that before we're finished.
Hold him, mistress, hold him there and I'll get the gun.
John, this is my brother, Will. You've heard me speak of him.
Oh, I thought for a minute you were a German in that case.
A German?
It's an ugly sight. Well, what is it?
Ah, the French Foreign Legion.
But how did you come to join that?
Well, when we got to the Argentine, Molly and me learned up the Spanish. I took up, we're Frenchmen there. So when I thought I'd like to see a bit of the war for myself, he got me enlisted with the French as an interpreter, seeing as I speak the three languages.
Oh, you were a fool to join, Will.
Maybe. And Ewan's down at Lanark, you say?
Aye, that's where he's doing his training.
Ach, he's either soft or daft. Or both. Joining up when he could have got himself exempted.
Well, what about you then?
Aye. Ach, I'm different, Chris. Whatever made you marry the doer devil?
Oh, because he was to me as Molly is to you.
Ah, well, we can't help it when things get that way.
What are you thinking?
Oh, just of how things were when we're bairns here together. What does Guy do, eh?
Sometimes Bonnie. Mind how we used to cuddle up at night together?
Now, the last time that happened was after Guthrie near killed me up at the barn.
You still haven't forgiven him?
Folk who ill-treat their bairns deserve to be shot.
I still wept at his graveside up in Kinradi Kirkyard.
God knows why.
How's Molly?
She's fine, grand. Oh, she likes the Argentine and the life out there.
But you'll come back, you and Molly, to bide in Scotland again.
The heavers who'd want to come back to this country. It's dead or dying. A damn good job.
Don't say that.
Have I made you angry?
Aye, you have. It's daft to say the country's dead. It can't die. This land will outlast us all and all our wars and Argentines. Long, long after all our little vexings are dead and gone, the wind will come sailing over the Grampians and the land will still be here.
As you say, Chris.
Aye, Will Guthrie's away, his leave finished yesterday. But Rob Duncan's back. Seems they put him in prison and they'll use him awful. The man's a total wreck, he can hardly stand or make his own meat. Serves him right, the coarse pro-German.
Guthrie.
Aye, it's me, Rob. And I've brought you some food. I've got some corn for you, but you don't look up to bruising it today. What are you doing sitting here? You should be in your bed.
I'm damned if I should have. However much a bed.
They treated you badly?
Bad enough. But I just laughed in their faces. And I went on hunger strike. I thought I'd just starve myself to death to spite them. But the doctor Child saw me growing weaker and weaker. He said there was no point in keeping me. I'd never be of use to my king and country.
Rob, lie down and rest for a bit.
No, I was just waiting for the grocer Child, but I didn't stop. Oh, he knows I'm at home. I suppose he has a nil will to pro-Germans like.
Oh, Ewan, if you'd seen that state he was in. I near wept at the sight of him. I sent John Brixton over to the farm at Auchinblay where Rob's horse and Shulty were housed. And next morning, I looked out and saw them in the field and heard a sound Kinraddy has missed for many a day.
In my bosom, lest my jewel I should find. Wishfully, I look.
When I listened to that singing, I dreamed that maybe the war will end soon and we'll all be back in Kinraddy together again.
Anguish, lest my weeping.
Bad news, mistress.
Good and bad, John. It's from Ewan. Home on leave tonight, before leaving for France. All day it lingered there at the back of my mind, like a black cat creeping at the back of a hedge. He was going to where the sky was troubled, and the earth shook night and day. But he would go with memories that were shining and brave. Ewan!
Hi, Chris. It's me, Ewan.
I've been wondering where you were these past 2 hours.
Stuff for a dram. But I'm here now, eh? Here, give us a kiss. Oh, well. Is there any supper, then? Or are you too bloody standoffish even to have that?
Standoffish? Oh, you...
I'm wearied. For God's sake, let a man sit down. And a blasted climb to a blasted place. Here, give us some tea.
Your supper's ready.
I said tea. Dammit, is that all you've got to say to me now that I've come home? Be better off spending the night with that tart in the town.
Oh, Ewan, what's happened to you?
God, what are you snivelling at now? You're always snivelling, am I? I'll be standoffish now if you can.
Ewan!
What the devil do you think I came home for, eh? God knows why I bothered. There are plenty of women in Lanark. Aye, and I've had them when I please.
I don't want to hear about them.
But you're going to, lass. You're going.
It was like struggling with someone deep in a nightmare. Oh, don't. Awful it was to think of Ewan like that. But it wasn't Ewan.
My Ewan. It was someone coarse and strange and strong, come back in his body to torment me. So that was his homecoming on leave. And the days that went by were the same as that first night foreshadowed. And in the days that followed, in place of love, hate came singing into my heart.
Is the dinner ready yet?
This while. Yours will be on the table in a minute, seeing you've decided to get up.
God, do you grudge me a bit of sleep in the mornings now?
No. I'm content to bring you your breakfast in bed, but there's things about the place you should be seeing to.
Now, what do you think I paid that for? I wonder myself sometimes. Good, what a glue. Eyes like his mother, and the nature the same.
If you've finished, away outside and play now. Come on. I've brushed your clothes for you. I thought you'd want to get out of uniform. I'm told the men get sick of wearing khaki. Would you like to wear your suit today?
Me? Dress up like a bloody conscience? No, I'll leave that to your friend, Rob Duncan.
Please yourself.
I'll need some money.
You know where it's kept? What do you want it for?
And what's that to you? Am I not entitled to what's my own? And maybe you think I'm still the young fool I was, contented slave away at Blaweary without so much as a dram to savour the sauce. I had a quine or so at night to waken the blood.
Ewan.
Nothing but a wife you had dearly touch, in case you put it in the family way. Hey, Chris?
Oh, excuse me, Mr. Zambert. Get on with it.
I suppose you'll be driving up to Stonehaven with Alec Mutch on one of your drunken sprees.
What if I am?
It's just that you could hardly abide the man at one time. Ewan, your leave's nearly up, and you've never once looked at the parks or the stock or even noticed your own bairn.
Aye, if he is.
Ewan!
Oh, leave me alone, woman. You'll be rid of me soon enough.
He stayed for 5 days. And often it seemed to me that a tortured, tormented thing looked out from the eyes of the lost lad I'd married. But the fancy wilted and vanished. And suddenly I was calm and secure, putting Ewan from my heart. I was finished with him, either in loving or hating.
Chris! What's the matter with you? Chris!
Take your toys outside.
Chris! I'm shouting to you! Chris! When the hell are you going to bring me some breakfast?
If you're in need of a breakfast, get it.
You bitch.
My God. You would, wouldn't you? Aye. That's a fine send-off for a man who's going to France to do his bit.
Oh, but your guy well up in the catchphrases.
Don't bloody well speak to me like
that. You needn't swear at me like that. It doesn't frighten me. No. You're the frightened one. You always have been.
You watch your mouth.
You know, I wonder. When I look at you, I wonder why I slaved and tended you and loved you and gave you the best.
I've had damn little of that these past few nights.
That was your own choosing. Though after the first, I'm not complaining. But I gave you a body and a mind and a soul. All of them a gift to a drunken lout from the Ploughstills.
He went slow down the road, believing that I would cry to him at the last. He stood there, fumbling with his cigarettes and matches as I watched. Then he went on down the road. It was strange, impossibly strange. I stood staring at that point where he'd vanished. And then it was. I found no salvation at all may endure forever, or beyond the pitch that the heart may bear it.
Hey, mistress, what ails you?
Oh, John, I let him go from Blaweary without a kiss or a parting word. Oh, Ewan, I didn't mean it. Oh, God, please make him come back. I should never have let him go like that.
There, now.
Don't let him go. Run after him, John.
The master?
My Ewan.
But, lassie, it's more than an hour since he went down the road. I heard, though, a long time ago the whistle of his train out over the hills.
Hello, Rob. I've just been out in the barn.
How's Chris? Bonny as ever. Ah, he's grown up to be a fine lad. Have you heard any word from his father?
Yesterday. After nearly a month. Just a scrape and a score and a thing they call a field postcard. From somewhere in France and said no more than that he was well.
But you'd be glad to get it anyway.
How was that? If I haven't had the harvest to keep my mind occupied.
I know. You've hardly been indoors from dawn till dusk. You're looking thinner than I've ever seen you, lass.
The arbol has to be cut.
And I'm here to help. I've no cutting of my own to do.
You've the mill to run.
There'll be a little loss at the mill. But the soul's driven up in his corn cart since I came back. I've nothing to do all day but clatter about in my park and look out to the road for custom that never comes.
Folk change. And they might again.
Maybe. But if they do, they can damn well wait. I've come to Stoop Blaweary.
So we went to the park, and we stooked it together. The best of the crop, and Rob as cheery as before. But sometimes, his eyes would wander up to the hills, like a man seeking a thing he had never desired. And into the iron blue eyes, a shadow, like a dark, quiet question would creep. Strange. I'd hardly known him before. Only as the miller with the twinkling eyes. Now it seemed I'd known him always. Closely and queerly. I felt shy as I sat by his side at the supper table. And when he bedded young Ewan at night, he'd sing him to sleep for a play. It was eerie listening to him, like listening to an echo from far in the ears at the mouth of a long-lost glen. I never knew when or how in the days that followed, but the knowledge came to me, out of the earth itself maybe, that I was Rob's to do with as he willed, as I willed. I wanted more, and in me was a prayer to the earth and the fields that this harvest might never end, and that the two of us would tramp it forever.
Well, Chris, lass, I've liked this fine. I'm away to Aberdeen to enlist the morn. I made up my mind days ago. I can't stay out of it any longer. All the world's gone daft, and I might as well go with the rest.
But why, Rob?
There's neither trade nor trust for me here, or rest ever again till this war's over.
if it ever ends at all.
Oh, Rob.
So, I'm giving in at last, suppose they'll say. And this is ta-ta, Chris. Mind me kindly sometimes. Well, lass. We're daft, Chris Quine. We mustn't.
Rob. We made no promises. Kissing for last. I knew already that he was growing remote from me. Remote to that madness that beckoned beyond the hills. It had burned up like a whin bush. And it had burned out again and was finished. I went about the Blue Weary Biggings next day, quiet and unvexed. We were one and the same. Ewan and me. There's no reply. What do I do? What do I do? John, you'll have to tell me. What do I do?
What is it, Mistress? Oh, is the master coming home again?
Well, I have to go out to France. What is it to do now?
God. Killed in action. Oh, this is sore news, Mistress.
But what am I supposed to do? Will he be lying in a room somewhere?
You do nothing, Mistress. They couldn't have took all the widows out to France.
But my Ewan, they'll show me him. Lying quiet and dead and white and bloodless.
He died like a man out there. Your Ewan died fighting.
But I want to see him, John.
But, Mistress, he's buried already.
Why didn't you tell me before? Oh, damn you! You like tormenting me.
Chris, you've a blip on yourself.
He isn't dead. He could never have died and be killed for nothing. What's their war got to do with him? They're only tormenting me. Liars and cowards. The generals and their like down in London. I'll have the law on them.
He's dead, Chris.
It's a lie. It's a lie. It's a lie.
Aye, he died fine. Young Ewan will grow up to be proud of his father. At least you have the consolation of knowing that he died for his king and country.
King and country? You're havering. Havering.
Oh, now, Chris.
He died for nothing. For nothing. Hurt and murdered and crying for me. And you bitches sit there and talk about king and country. Get out. Get out.
Don't worry.
Get out of the weary.
She went fair daft with rage then. And me and Mrs. Monroe went running out of the house and down the brae with Chris at the door still screaming after us.
So I was hearing. Well, there's not many who'll go to see her if she carries on that way. It's the speaker can rally the way she's been behaving.
Poor Chris.
What a way to carry on. shouting, screaming.
But I'd finished with screaming. Mornings came up, and I saw them come. Minding that morning, I sent them away. Noons with their sun and rain came over the house, and I saw the cruelty and pain of life as crimson rainbows. Nights came, soft and grey and quiet, but they brought neither terror nor hope. Behind the walls of sanity, cold and high, locked in from the lie of life, I would live. Far from the world that had murdered my man for nothing. For a madman's gibberish, heard in the night behind the hills.
It's grand to see you. The Major Sergeant.
Aye. Just over a few days' leave. Neil comes straight here from the train.
Why's that?
Chris, I've come to tell you of Ewan.
Ewan? Oh, Jay, he's not living.
No. Ewan's dead. Don't vex yourself hoping for anything else. I can't hurt him more. Even this can't hurt him, though I swore to him that I would say nothing about it, but I know right well you should hear it, Chris.
I'm listening, Jay.
Ewan was shot as a coward and deserter out there in France.
No.
It's always best to know what truth's in a thing. Lies come creeping home to roost in funny ways, Chris Quine. You're young yet. It had begun to live. And I swore to myself I would tell you it all.
Aye, Jay. Aye, it's best to know the truth.
Ewan was shot as a deserter. It was fair enough. He deserted from the front line trenches. Saw a blink of fine weather, he said. Just got up and walked back.
You said he told you this?
Aye. I was in a camp nearby and I heard just by chance. I saw Ewan's name in some papers that were posted up. I went to see him the night before before he was shot.
But why did you do it, Ewan? I didn't know we'd ever get free, man.
It was the wind that came with the sun, Jay. I minded blow eerie. I seemed to waken up smelling that smell. I couldn't believe it was me standing in the trench. It was just daft to be there. So I turned and got out of it.
Oh, man. If only you thought.
But I did. It came to me in a flash. The memory of Chris at Blaweary and the way I treated her the last time I was there. Like a devil, Jay. Mad I was. I knew I'd lost her as soon as I climbed out of the trench, but I knew, too, that I'd be a coward if I didn't try and win her back.
You did no chance of reaching her, man.
I knew that. I knew it as I tramped mile after mile. But I'd promised her that I wouldn't fail her long ago. And I thought of young Ewan. I'd so much to do and so much to say. If only I could win back to Blaweary.
Did you tell him this at the court-martial?
No. I was wearied, Jay. Wearied and wakened at last. I haven't cared. They can take me out fine and shoot me tomorrow. I'll be glad for the rest of it. Chris lost me through my own daftness. She didn't even come to give me a kiss at goodbye, Jay. We never said goodbye. I mind the bonny head of her bent down there in the yard. She'll never know, my dear lass, and that's best. They tell lies about people they shoot. She'll think I just died like the rest. You're not to tell her, Che.
No. Goodman, try for a reprieve, but it's useless, me being only a sergeant.
I've no business to be here at all.
You mind the smell of dung in the fields on an April morning, Che? And the peeweeds over the ricks. Bonnie. They're flying this night in Kinradi. Chris sleeping there. And all the hoe happed and missed.
I'm a new one, but you should be thinking of other things, man. Dawn's gay close. Have you seen a minister?
Some old bit Billy came in and blathered. Officer creature he was. I paid him no heed. It's nothing to do with me.
It's gay close.
I keep thinking about Blue Eyrie. The parks will need draining. The land will go to hell without the woods to shelter it.
Ah, you're right there. There's some sore changes waiting for us when we get back.
Hey, mind the night of the lightning, Che. When I went out and found Chris wandering the fields looking for our horses. That was the night I knew she liked me right well. Nothing more than that. So quick and fierce she was. Che, man, she guarded herself like a queen in a palace. There was nothing between her and me till the night we married. You mind that night, Che? The singing there was. What was it Chris sang then? What was it? How could I have forgotten that?
He wasn't feared or crying, Chris. He was quiet and calm. And they killed him that morning.
Never vex for me, or the telling of me this. It was best. It was best. You did it for me, and I'm proud and proud. For me and Blue Eyrie, my dear, my dear. I was at peace with myself, knowing that Ewan's last thoughts had been on me and this land, with its springs and winters, and all the sounds and scents of it that had once been a passion of his blood and spirit. And who knows what memories of it were with the others who died in France.
Maybe this place could be bought for a pound or two now.
Oh, I could hardly believe my eyes when I read it'd been killed in the papers. What was it you used to say? They're all the same, Scotch or German.
I'm such a pacifist, too. Hello, Chris. We were just talking about Long Rob. He's been killed in France.
I know.
Aye, the paper said he'd been killed in a retreat. Him and two or three other billies.
We're giving him a medal?
Not that he'll get it.
Oh, faith, no. But it'll be a token of respect.
Well, he died a hero.
Aye, he must have been fine stock in spite of all his coarse talk about religion.
There was more sweetness and sense in Rob's little finger than in all the Monroe carcasses collected since the flood. So Long Rob never came back to the mill. And this ended as everything else. Everything I had ever loved and desired went out to the madness beyond the hills.
on that old road that flung its evil white ribbon down into the dusk. And an hour before the guns grew quiet on Armistice Day, Che Strachan was killed in the last of the fighting.
He knew right well he'd never come back, Chris. He tramped the parks most of the time, muttering about the woods he'd cut, and that the land would never get over it. When he said goodbye to me, it wasn't just the usual slap on the shoulder. He held me and kissed me at the station and said, "Be good to the bairns. They're all gone, Chris."
"Aye. The finest and the best."
"Ye mind them, surely. Fech, it was no sermon at all. And the son's no much better."
"He's 10 times worse. Cahoon's barely been here a month and he's made himself fair objectionable. The way he's helping the ploughman's union and storming on at the farmers to pay more."
"It's just rank sedition. But what can you expect from a minister that whistles on a Sunday and won't wear a collar that fastens at the back?"
"Likely be a poor German, eh?"
"Oh, no, you could hardly call him that, for he was a plain soldier all through the war."
"He's a Bolshevik."
"Aye, that's it. He's a Bolshevik. One of these coarse stinks that made such a splutter in Russia. They tell me a man can go home and find his wife commandeered any night and Lenin or Trotsky lying where."
"The same could come in Kerady if Cahoon had his way. We have to think of our wives."
"God knows Lenin and Trotsky would need to be fair desperate afore they go to that length."
"Eh?"
"And I'll tell you something else. There's money a decent thinking out of Kinradi with the war, but only one's come in, and that's the new minister."
"Well, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen." "And I have an announcement to make. As you know, I was entrusted with the funds to raise a memorial to those men of Kinradi who fell in the war. Suggestions have been made that a stone angel should be erected at the crossroads. I have decided, however, on reflection, that then memory would be more simply and lastingly served by inscribing their names on the stone circle at Blueweary Loch. Accordingly, I have had this done, and the Kinradi Memorial will be unveiled next Saturday. I shall expect a fine attendance, whatever the weather. They had to attend in ill weather, the folk that fell. For I will give you the morning star. In the sunset of an age and an epoch, we may write that for epitaph of the men who were of it. They went quiet and brave from the lands they loved, though seldom of that love might speak. It was not in them to tell in words of the earth that moved and lived and abided. Their life and their enduring love. With them we may say there died a thing older than themselves. They were the last of their kind. The last of the old Scots folk. A new generation comes up that will know them not, except as a memory in a song. They passed with the things that seemed good to them, with loves and desires that grow dim in the alien days to be. The land changes,
their parks, their steadings, and the desolation where sheep are pastured. The crofter has gone. The man with a house of his own. And the land closer to his heart than the flesh of his body. Nothing is true but change. Nothing abides. And here in Kinraddy, where we watch the building of those little prides and little fortunes on the ruins of the little farms, we must also give heed that these do not abide. They died for a world that is past. These men. But they did not die for this that we seem to inherit. Let us believe then that the new oppressions and the foolish greeds are no more than mists that pass. Let us believe that, lest we shame these men, though they cry to us even now, from the places of the sunset.
The tune fair tore at your heart, leaping up the moor and echoing across the loch. I alone never shed a tear, but stood quiet, holding my boy by the hand and looking down on Blueary's fields. We had the last of the light up there, but maybe I didn't need it or heed it. You can do without the day, if you've a lamp quiet lighted and kind in your heart.